Well, it's a good day in the house of the Lord. I already feel really blessed, and I could go home now, but we're going to share a little bit on fellowship. You may be thinking, oh, I know all about fellowship. That's when we all get in the fellowship hall and bring food, and bring a dish and eat. And, you know, fellowship's so much more than that. And you may say it's two fellers in a ship heading in the same direction. I've heard that all my life. Well, that's not fellowship either. These two fellers might be in conflict. There may be disunity. They may not know. They could be in the same ship going to the same place, but not really have fellowship. You can live with someone and not have fellowship. You can work with someone. You come to church with people and not have fellowship. So anyway, it's one of the purposes of Return Church. This would be the last part of this series, this series on the purposes of Return Church. This will be our last lesson. It's entitled Fellowship. Our statement of purpose, of course, is Return Church is a family of diverse individuals returning to what matters, which is an intimate love relationship with Jesus Christ. Our purpose is to glorify Jesus in all we do through worship, evangelism, discipleship, ministry, fellowship, and helping the vulnerable. All of these are important components of who we are as a church and why we exist as a church and what God wants to do through us as a church. Now, this word in the Greek for fellowship, I gave it to you in the Greek. I gave you the way it sounds and the way it's spelled. I don't even know how to pronounce it. Koinonia. Koinonia is my best shot at it. It means fellowship. Communion. It's the same word when we have communion or the Lord's table at the Lord's Supper. That same word, communion, is fellowship. It means intimacy. Intimacy. Same thought here. Fellowship is communion, is intimacy. Lesser meanings, participation or social intercourse, communicate, distribution, association, community, a gift jointly contributed or a collection. So that's what koinonia means. And so in the New Testament, when you see the word fellowship or communion, this is what God's saying. So we understand that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit all have a perfect fellowship. They have a perfect relationship. All three have the same name, same nature, same will, same purpose. They're not going in three different directions. They're all united. They're one with each other. Three persons, but one God. Three, but one. And I could talk on this for hours. We could do a series on the Trinity. I'd still never be able to completely explain it because I'll never be able to completely understand it. But I do know that we're a body, soul, and a spirit, but yet one person. And God's one God, but He's God the Father, the person of God the Father, God the Son, the person of God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, He's a person. The Holy Spirit's on this earth now. He's a person. He's the most fantastic person you will ever meet. He's the kindest, gentlest, most gracious, merciful. He has a sense of humor. Get to know the Holy Spirit, all right? But there's not three gods. They don't even have three names. There's one name. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The only way we're ever going to know the Father is to go through the Son. You can't even come to the Son unless the Holy Spirit draws you. So all three are involved in your restoration or your reconciliation or your redemption, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. But they're not fighting each other. They're not at a conference table. One of them's got an idea, floating a new idea, and the other one said, nah, I don't think that's right. No, they're exactly in sync on everything. And the Son proved it his whole life on the earth. All he did was give glory to his Father. He never took glory for himself. He never took praise for himself. The glory was to his Father. And the Father was just glorifying the Son. And the Son was glorifying the Father. And now the Holy Spirit's on the earth, and He glorifies the Son and glorifies the Father. None of them ever step in the middle and say, I'm the man, or I'm the big shot, or we're going to do it my way. That's all satanic human thinking. And God the Father's way above that. The fellowship, the relationship, the intimacy, the communion between God the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is absolutely perfect. Now that you needed to really understand that, because when you're putting all your trust in Him, when you're going through a hellacious storm, and life's falling apart. Beloved, you serve a God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, that's going to help you and love you, and they're united in purpose, in character, in nature, in name, in will. Perfect, perfect. So there's one God. It's easier to think one God, but he's three persons. All right, I'm going to move on. I think I made my point. Jesus said in John 17, he prayed. He was talking about his 12 disciples. He said, keep them in your name, praying to the Father, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. So Jesus and the Father had this amazing unity, unbroken relationship. And now he's saying, I want the same thing for my 12 disciples. Father, make them one as we are one. Amazing. Think about that. And then he dropped down a few verses later. He said, I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. So that's me and you. Not just the 12 disciples. He's saying, you know, everybody that's going to become a believer, he says that they all may be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one, we being him and the Father, that the church might be as one with each other as Jesus was with the Father. Are you seeing that? I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you love me. John 17, powerful, very powerful. His prayer was that the believers would all be one. See, all of mankind has a deep, deep longing in our hearts to be loved, to be valued, to be accepted, to be appreciated. You know, that's one thing whether you're in Bangladesh or Hong Kong or Kenya, anywhere you go, anywhere in the world. Everybody you see has the same need to be loved. Everybody. And we all have this longing in our life. We're looking for something. We're searching for something. There's this thing in us that's yearning for fellowship, learning for relationship, yearning for communion, yearning for intimacy. And most people screw up their lives in a lot of ways by trying to get a person to do that for them. No person, I don't care how wonderful Prince Charming is, he's not God, and he can't feel that need I'm talking about. He can't feel that longing. Or you may have married Miss Universe, and guess what, honey? She's still not going to be able to feel that longing you have for fellowship. Because Ecclesiastes 3:11 says, yet God hath made everything beautiful in his own time. He has planted eternity in the human heart. So inside of you, he planted eternity there. But even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to end. So he's put something in you that nothing temporal can satisfy. Nothing of this world that's here for a little while then gone tomorrow can satisfy that eternal longing you have. Only God can do that. Only eternity himself. So when you find Jesus and Jesus comes in and touches that deep well inside of you, that eternal part of you, and you get born again, then you have a satisfaction and a fulfillment that should cause you to quit looking for love in all the wrong places. Now you ought to be satisfied of who you are in Christ and then learn how to love people with Christian godly fellowship. So that's what we're shooting for here, okay? How to do that. Now the great commandment, I spoke this last week. We know the Great Commission. We talked about that a couple weeks. That the great commandments, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. That means with everything you got, love him. And the second is this, you shall love your neighbors yourself. There's no other commandment greater than these. Now the truth is, it's easier to love God than it is to love people. Because the more you get to know God, he's just fantastic in every way. He loves you. He forgives you when you mess up. He's gracious to you. He puts his favor on us when we don't deserve it. I mean, he's easy to love. You really get to know him, he's pretty easy to love. But a human being, if you're not careful, you get to know them too well, all of a sudden they're not so easy to love. Once we're born again and come from death to life, we should no longer be empty and unfulfilled or unsatisfied. Now that we're in Christ, and Christ in us, we're to spend our lives loving others. We talked about last week how we're to minister to people and help people. Yes. Well, see, Christian fellowship is kind of married to that concept. Ministry is more about work and activity and serving and helping. Fellowship, you're actually doing that as you connect with people, as you share with people, as you encourage people. So in one point, fellowship has a ministry component, but that's only the part about that's going out of you. What you also need is this part coming inside of you. See, ministry is just pouring out to others. Fellowship, yeah, you're pouring out and you're receiving. Man, if you get around some Christian friends and you give them a word of encouragement, and then they give you a word of encouragement. You build them up, then they build you up. Then somebody's there in a crisis, and you rally around that person and pray for them and get their broken heart mended and put them back together again. Then somebody has a Bible study or a word of scripture for people. And man, good Christian fellowship, when you leave there, you're going to be strong and mighty in your faith. You're going to feel like you could bust hell wide open with a water pistol and every devil out of in hell would run away from you. Good fellowship should encourage your heart. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So fellowship that's built upon the word of God should be very encouraging to everybody. Now, we know it can go the other way. It's all relational. We talked the other day, Brother Ben started this series with the lesson on worship. And worship's all about your relationship with God. It's just loving God, loving on him, putting him number one, putting him first in your life, giving your heart to him. Worship is all about your relationship with God. Evangelism, about your relationship with the lost. Discipleship's about your relationship with believers. Ministry's about your service and your relationship to believers and unbelievers. Helping the vulnerable is about the relationship you have with those that are having a hard time in society. But fellowship is also totally relational. And I use this word a lot because we must start thinking this way, that this is all about building relationships, building friendships, helping people, loving people, serving people, encouraging people, building people up in the Lord. Everything we do at Return is relational. And all relationships should be built upon Jesus Christ. Some people think that Christianity is all about how many mysteries they know, how much knowledge they've acquired over the years. They think they have more faith than anybody else. And God made it real clear here in 1 Corinthians 13. You can have all of that, but if you don't have love, you don't have anything. You don't have anything. It's just a big fake. It's just a big head probably is what it is. He said it this way in ESV, if I speak in the tongues of men and angels, it means I can have these supernatural tongues and have not love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, now that's a lot. Think about that. I got all the mysteries, know all the knowledge, I got prophetic powers, I can move mountains. But if I have not love, I am nothing. Nothing. Your Christianity is a joke. You got gifts, so what? Where's the love? Walking in hate, walking in unforgiveness, walking around, where's the love? If I give away all that I have, now, I could spend every dollar I have on the homeless in Portland, but if I don't have love, what good does that do me? Even if I deliver my body to be burned, that means maybe there were some martyrs that gave their life for Christ but didn't have love. if I have not love, I gain nothing. Jesus told his disciples, by this all people will know that you're my disciples, if you have love one for another. That's the sign. That's the mark. That's the demonstration. That's the manifestation. That's how the world's going to know we're different, because we love one another. Y'all follow me there. I'm going to read this, and I'm going to give you a demonstration. Early church. This is Acts 2. So this is right after the day of Pentecost. The church was just forming. The Bible says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. See what they devoted themselves to? The teaching of the word of God coming from the apostles, fellowship amongst each other, breaking of bread, eating with each other, and prayers. Awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad, generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their numbers day by day those who were being saved. So if we want to go to look at the early church model, they had the word of God. That was important. They even had miracles happening. They were evangelistic. People were getting saved. The Lord added to the church. But don't skip over this part, how they went from home to home breaking bread and fellowshipping with each other. Very, very important in the Christian walk. Communion. Can I have two men to help me real quick with this table? When we talk about communion, usually we go to 1 Corinthians 10, 16, 17. Thank y'all. If y'all could just bring it here. 1 Corinthians 10, 16, 17 in King James says, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion? Yeah, let's go. Let's pull it back just a little bit this way. Perfect. Thank you very much. Is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we being many are one bread and one body, for we are all partakers of that one bread. So I want to make a demonstration that, we have this relationship with God. God the Father through the Son, through the broken body and the poured out blood of Jesus Christ. It's the only reason you have any fellowship with God. The only reason you know God. The only reason you can walk with God and put your trust in God is because of the sacrifice of the poured out blood and the broken body of Jesus. My favorite verse in the Bible, 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. He became our sin. He went to the cross and took all of our sin upon himself, and he actually became our sin. He was righteous. He had never broken unity with the Father. He was holy. He was perfect. But he's in our place, went to the cross as a substitutionary sacrificial offering. And his nails were hammered into his hands and nails hammered into his feet and blood poured from his brow and from his beaten back. And so we go to the table and we see the bread. He says, do this in remembrance of me. Eat in remembrance of me, that you might have communion with the Father. That you might... Here's my blood. The new covenant is in the cup. The blood is spilled at Calvary. So go to the table and remember me and drink the blood, that you might have communion with the Father. He wants you and I to have intimacy, a relationship, a personal relationship with God. God Almighty and me, little old me down here in this world, I can have this amazing relationship with God. You don't have to go to Bible school to have an amazing relationship with Jesus. You don't have to be anything. You just got to be willing to eat of the body and drink of his blood. If you're willing to repent of your sins and give your heart to him. We were singing this morning, "Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart. Here's my heart." Confess your sin. Confess your sin. Get it out. Let it go. Just let it go. Give it to him. Because the blood of Jesus will come and wash all of your sins away. He not only will wash them away, but he'll forget them. It's a very, very powerful thing at the table. So we can have communion with God because of the blood of Jesus and the broken body of Jesus. Amen? All right, I'm going to make another point. Again, we're always going to have a chair in this church for the lost. I don't care what they look like when they come in here. I don't care what they look, what they got on or off. It doesn't matter. If they got tattoos or piercings or it doesn't matter. I mean, if they're lost, they're going to be in the world. And we got to let them belong before they believe. So what we were going to do at returns, we're going to keep loving these people that come in that are lost. I hope you're all wearing your little bracelets. I'm wearing mine. I've had almost 40 conversations now since I wore this. And it's amazing the kind of conversations you can have telling people what those four little symbols mean. But we're going to be evangelistic. We're going to reach out to the lost. But ultimately, we want them to get saved, and we're going to trust God to save them, and they will get saved. So, Scotty, won't you sit down in the believer chair? There's not only chairs for the lost, but there's chairs for these new believers. These new believers need to grow in Christ and Christ in them. They need to become mature. You can't expect a new believer to be like an old believer. They're going to have all kinds of sins and hang-ups and quirks and things that are wrong. I mean, they're going to be that way for a while. It takes a while to grow in God. So quit judging people because they don't live to the same pious standard you live to. Learn to love them where they are, and if you'll encourage them, they will grow in Christ. Amen? All right, I need a lady now. Sister Pam, won't you help me? You can do that. So we're going to let Sister Pam be the minister. We learned that the minister is not the big shot, but the minister is a servant, right? The minister is the one that takes the towel and washes feet. And you can get down low enough with the lost people, if they got rejection on their feet, you love them enough and wash their feet, you can wash that rejection off of them. If they've got any kind of pain in life or anger or depression or addiction or what, just get down and love them, wash their feet, and watch these people get well. So a minister is a servant. We learned it really means to wait tables. So if you want to minister, it's the low place. It's the role of a servant. It's not being the big shot or bossing. And then I need a disciple. Let's pick a gray-haired fellow, all right? Somebody that's got a few years on him. Give me a volunteer here. Yeah, there you go, brother. Sure, a disciple. Now, here's what's important to know. Just because your hair's gray don't mean you made it to a disciple maker, all right? I know Christians, really, that have been babies their whole life. They're old. And they're still babies, and they still act like babies. But you can actually be a young person, and in 3.5 years go from being an unbeliever to a disciple maker, because that's what Jesus had. He had these 11 young guys. Well, we really don't know how old they are, but we can kind of guess somewhat by looking at John's life and about how old he was when he wrote the book of Revelation. So I think they were kind of similar to the age of Jesus, probably in their 30s. And in 3.5 years, they became a disciple maker. So it's not just age determines this or how many years you've been in church. See, you can, being in church doesn't make you a disciple any more than spending some time in your garage makes you a car. Okay? I mean, start hanging out in the garage. Just hang out there all week. You're not going to become a car. And you may not become a disciple by hanging out in church. There's a price tag on that. There's choices you got to make. All right, so the cool thing about this, there's four steps. We've been learning that. But what I want you to understand is all four of them sit at the same table. So y'all take your chairs down and put around the table there. All four sit at the same table. The unbeliever, the new Christian, the more mature Christian that's ministering and helping, and the old seasoned disciple maker. All four are going to sit at the table. And they're at the table of fellowship. They're going to eat together and laugh together and cry together and share together and study together. They're going to understand fellowship. No one's going to judge the other. Everyone's going to be helping and loving one another. All are going to be at different levels of spiritual growth. You're going to learn how to accept people for who they are in Christ and quit judging them. Quit looking at the splinter in their eye while you got a whole tree growing out of your face, all right? Now, the Bible says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him, and he with me." Now, the context that's used by evangelists all the time, probably not perfectly correct, because what he was really referring to was the backslidden, lukewarm, Laodicean church age. They thought they were rich, increased with goods, and needed nothing. They thought they have all of God we need, so we're just backslidden, we're lukewarm. He said, "You're neither hot nor cold. I'm going to spit you out of my mouth because you've become lukewarm." And he said, "You need to buy some gold tried in the fire and white linen or raiment that you might be, your nakedness might be clothed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve." And he was trying to say, you got to get your act together here. I'm outside the door. I'm knocking on the church. This isn't talking about just knocking on one door. He was knocking on the door of the Laodicean church. And we live in the Laodicean church age. So that means we could almost get a picture of Jesus knocking on the door saying, "Come in, let me in there, because I want to dine with you. I want to have fellowship with you." So the key to fellowship is understanding that the Jesus, the wine and the bread I put on the table, represents him. And our fellowship needs to be centered around him. He said here in his word that where two or three are gathered in my name, I'm among them. King James says, "I'm in the midst." And I don't know how many times y'all have experienced that, but when you got just three people praying and how powerful it can be, and when the presence of God shows up. See, you got to realize when you're together with two or three, something powerful can happen. When Jesus actually is in the midst of the fellowship, Jesus is at the table. Now, the sinner, what did he bring to the table? All he had was his sin. So he brought his sin, and he swapped his sin for the blood of Jesus and the body of Jesus. He swapped his sinfulness for Christ's righteousness. So now Christ, he's now born again, and God's put his righteousness on him. The believer, same thing, but he came to this table of fellowship already clothed in Christ, as well as the minister and the disciple maker. So be careful. Don't bring up, like drag up your old man and try to bring him to this table, because that'd be like bringing a corpse. That'd be like going to small group and bringing a dead corpse with you and dragging that in the house and say, "This is what we're going to eat on here today." No, your old man is dead. He's dead. He's buried. He's baptized. He's planted. You've been raised to life. If you're a Christian, you've come from the dead and been raised from the dead to walk in newness of life. So what we bring is our new man to the table. And our fellowship should be all centered around Jesus. 1 John 1. "That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us." This is the Apostle John writing. He was talking about how they had this great fellowship with Jesus, how John used to walk with him. John used to lay his head on the chest of Jesus. He was very, very close to Jesus. And he's saying, "I want you too to have this kind of walk with him." And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. And we're writing these things so our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light and in him there's no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. So you can be at the table and have all kind of sin going in your life and pretend, but you know you're not in communion with him. And if you got smart people at the table, they're going to know also. And you can try to get near or close your Christian friends, But if you got this sin rolling around, unconfessed, unrepented sin going on, it breaks the unity. Are y'all following that? I know y'all don't like me talking about sin, but if you don't hear it, you're not going to get rid of it. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie, we do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. Not just with God, but with each other. And if we don't have to be perfect, but we can walk in light. We walk in what we know to walk in. He says, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth's not in us. But if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word's not in us. So let's just look at a couple things real quick. If you say you've got no sin in your life, what are you? A liar. Yeah. So it's okay, all right? None of us are perfect. We all have sin. What do we do with it? Confess it. Just deal with it. Get honest with it. You got a nasty attitude? Just pray, Lord Jesus, I see it. My attitude's wrong. I confess it to you. I repent of it. You got having problems with your mind? You got a lustful mind? Just confess it to the Lord. You're angry. You're depressed. You're murmuring. You're complaining. Just confess it. Remember I taught you how to breathe spiritually? When you're confessing sin, it's like an exhale. And then when you inhale, see, you understand when you're confessing it to Jesus and you're asking Jesus to take it away, then his grace and blood is so powerful that actually as you inhale, he can immediately remove it. Breathe. Everybody do that together. Blow out. Now breathe in. That's how long it should take for you to confess sin. You give it to him, you receive his grace. You confess your junk, you receive his grace, his favor, his forgiveness, his mercy. See, learn to do that and you can stay at the table and have fellowship one with another. Fellowship with God and fellowship with others. When you stop doing that, you break your unity with God and you may be at the table, but they know it, you know it, something's not right. Why don't you turn your chair the other way? Face that way. I'm going to pick on you. All right? So something's not right. Something's wrong with Sister Pam, you know? Something's been eaten at her. See, what really happened, someone offended her and she didn't forgive the person. So even though she's at the table, the circle's not right. You don't feel the connection that you could because of the unforgiveness. All she has to do is, Lord, give me the power to forgive that person, to cancel that debt. And God, I do it. I just forgive. I let it go. And as soon as you do that, flip it back around. You get back in communion with your brothers and sisters. Y'all following this? How to have fellowship with God and others. I'm almost done. What spoils Christian fellowship? The most, number one thing is unforgiveness. Number two, offense is not being dealt with properly. Number three, disunity over vital doctrinal truth. If you spoil your fellowship over whether the rapture is pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, shame on you. Yes. Come on. Let your brother believe whatever he wants to believe there. If you spoil your Christian fellowship over these lesser details of the Bible, shame on you. Now, you got a Jehovah Witness at the table, and he's arguing you down that Jesus is not the Son of God, and he's not ever going to get saved, there's no drawing, he's just there as an ambassador of the devil, then you give him the left foot of fellowship, all right? But Christians are supposed to be in unity over the vital organs of Christianity, and don't let more or lesser important things where we have opinions or ideas or feelings about destroy your fellowship. The other thing is the uncontrolled tongue. Gossip, scorning, lying, deceiving, flattering. You can walk in a small group with a bad attitude and start saying something you shouldn't say. It kills the whole thing. Undefined or unclear boundaries. How many know every relationship has to have boundaries? Every relationship. And you got to learn where those boundaries are. And everybody has to respect those boundaries. If somebody jumps over the fence, it can destroy the whole thing. Miscommunication, just a lack of understanding. You heard somebody say something about you, so you're mad? Oh, really? Why don't you do what the Bible says and go to your brother and find out what they really said about you? I didn't say that. Well, I heard you said that. Who'd you hear it from? Well, I'm not sure. I mean, it can get crazy. Gossip, tail, what do they call that? Tattle? No. Not tattle, tail bearing. There's a word in the Bible. The Bible uses the word, King James, tail bearing. Undefined or unclear boundaries. Miscommunication. Here's the big one. Distrust. If there's distrust in the room, there'll be a lack of vulnerability. So you need to learn when you got your group of accountability partners or your small group, your prayer meeting, that what's said in the room stays in the room. You got to build trust there amongst each other. And then worldly content will destroy it. If you push the bread and the wine off the table and put something of the world there, you're going to have fellowship based on a worldly thing. That's going to fall apart really, really quick. Our fellowship has to be about Jesus. The Bible says, I'm closing, one more slide. Peter came up and said to Jesus, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me? And I have to forgive him. I forgive him. I mean, really, this is going on long enough, he's saying. As many as 7 times? And Jesus said, I do not say to you 7 times, but 70 times 7. 490 times, Peter. I don't care if they forgive, offend you today and tomorrow and the next day, next Sunday, every Sunday they're going to keep offending you. How long do I have to do this? Really, God? Yeah, really. 70 times 7. Keep forgiving. There is no end to forgiveness. And God will test you, and He'll use one particular person to do it. And if you fall out and quit forgiving that person, you break your fellowship with God, your communion with God, and you break your fellowship with others. Jesus said, if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Now think about that. That means the love of God is unconditional, but the forgiveness of God is conditional. You want to keep getting forgiven? You got to keep forgiving. Some people are stuck right here. They're never going to go further with God. They're never going to have a relationship with God because they cannot forgive this person that harmed them so bad. Man, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. I promise you, that person is not worth it. I'm not going to miss out with God and all He's got for my life because of one knuckleheaded person that I can't forgive. Just let it go. Let it go. Cancel that debt. Let it go. Forgive. You forgive, then the grace of God starts flowing back in your life and God will forgive you. Bible also says if your brother sins against you, go tell 20 people in the church. Put it on Facebook. What does it say? Go tell him his fault. Hey, dude, what'd you do that for? Between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you've gained your brother. I just say this because I see it. We used to be in a culture that if you did something wrong, you go tell your pastor instead of the person. Then we'd sit on opposite sides of the church for the rest of your life. That ain't the way to do it. We don't mean to offend people, but we will, usually not meaning to. So if you get offended, what do? Go to the person. Call the person. Go see the person. Talk to the person. Make it right. Humble yourself. Make it right. This is the key to keeping good communion, good fellowship. All right, so what spoils Christian fellowship? Unforgiveness. Offense is not being dealt with properly. The way to deal with them properly is to go to the person. Disunity over doctrinal truth, the uncontrolled tongue. If you're a small group leader and somebody comes in there and they just start all this negative talk about things, it's up to you to shut that down right away. Because an uncontrolled tongue, and the Bible says, who's able to control their tongue according to the book of James? A perfect person. Is there one of them on the earth? Does that mean all of us are going to say stupid bonehead things sometimes? Yeah, that's what we are. Undefined or unclear boundaries. Distrust, miscommunication, or worldly content. Now, I got to give you this last thing. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness? Now, for the unbeliever, which one of y'all represented the unbeliever? Hilton, yeah, you were, okay. So the unbeliever's part of our church, and he's joined a small group, and we're witnessing to him, we're loving him. But all of a sudden, he's not yet converted, and he's got all kind of worldly junk in his head. So he brings and shares some of the world, something deceptive, something worldly, to the table. See, here's where you got a mature Christian at the table and a minister and a growing Christian, how they have to push that back. And you can still love this guy. Get out, wash his feet, wash the dirt off his feet, and you still try to include him. But if the world is trying to convert you, and that's more powerful than the group, then it's time to ask that person to leave. Now, he's not saying don't go out and be friends with the world. Jesus was a friend of sinners. What he's saying is don't get yoked to them. If you're getting married, it needs to be a Christian, okay? You're going into business with somebody, it needs to be a Christian. You're partner with somebody, y'all both need to be believers. Don't be yoked with unbelievers. Can y'all see that? Amen. But a lot of Christians take this verse and shut down evangelism and don't bring people in the house of God. That's not what it's saying. Jesus was a friend of sinners, and we will be too. Thank y'all for your help. Y'all may get down. Give them all a hand clap for helping me out. My point was, those four chairs that we've been talking about all sit at the same table of fellowship. And Jesus wants to dine with us, eat with us. And if we keep the Word of God as our focal point of our fellowship, we can have this beautiful harmony and beautiful intimacy and a beautiful friendships. I'm saying it this way. I cannot overemphasize enough the importance of a circle of Christian friends for all believers to be connected to. Connect groups, discipleship classes, prayer meetings, mentoring. There's lots of different settings we can get in. We need to encourage, build up, and comfort one another. We need to pour into others, give ourselves away for the cause of Christ. New believers and mature believers all need Christian fellowship. See, if you've been with God so long, you might get to think, I don't need. Well, they need you, so you don't get it. You need to be fellowshipping because you need to be pouring yourself into them. Yes. New believers need the older believers to pour into them. Yes. And you older believers need to obey God and serve and humble yourself and help the new believers. So we're going to close this today and close this series with the thought that return, that we're better together. And we're growing stronger together. And what we're changing the way we meet with staff and ministry leaders. We're doing lots of things. We're doing it together. But one big, big thing at return is we only got about half of you guys connected in some kind of small group or a discipleship class or a prayer meeting. And seriously, if you've only been a believer for less than 6 months, you desperately must get in a group. It's a matter of life and death. You're a tender little plant, and the devil wants to kill, steal, and destroy. And so we want to get everybody plugged in. You don't have to. We're not pushing you. We're not forcing you. We're not twisting your arm. I just want you to know it's important. You might be shy and just kind of an introvert. But boy, I promise you, you need this kind of connection with people. You need this connection with Christians. You need, this will help you in your journey more than coming on Sunday morning and hearing a sermon. This will be, when you get a circle of friends or accountability partners that you can pray with and share your burdens with and share your difficulties with, beloved, you'll see the beauty of it. So I'm strongly urging you as your pastor to explore this with me. We're going to take just a couple minutes. I'm going to have Rebecca come, and we're going to talk about it. Are you ready, Sister Rebecca?